Well, good afternoon or good morning, depending on what time you're viewing this video. I'm certainly excited about the opportunity that's been presented to me by Chief Justice Ravner and, of course, to my dear friend and, I mean, one of the trailblazers in our community, Judge Grant. Thank him and thank you so much, Judge, for all that you do to all justices that have gathered and all the persons that are in the room on this day to discuss the very important task of jury selections. You know, I read somewhere, I'm trying to remember and to recall where I read it, about New Jersey courts, and New Jersey courts being one of independence, integrity, fairness, and quality service. I don't know if these are the core values of the court. I don't know if these are the tenets of the court. Whatever they might be, my question is, how do we live out independence, integrity, fairness, and quality service? It's apparent to me in the various backgrounds that I'm privileged to work in that we use certain language and certain words as trademarks for not only a corporation, but for industry or for an organization. But the question always that grips me is, how do we live out these words of fairness and integrity in particular? Or must we ask the question, is it really fairness and integrity when it comes to the jury selection in the state of New Jersey? Is it really independence and quality service when we talk about the jury selection in the state of New Jersey? Or is it filled with racism? Is it filled with implicit bias? Is it filled with prejudice? Those are all the dynamics that we must wrestle with and all the dynamics that we must deal with when we're talking about jury selections. You know, at one point I had this goal, I had this dream of going to law school. But after 3 degrees, I said, you know, I was fortunate enough to have a scholarship for two of them. For the third, I was fortunate enough to pastor a church that helped me tremendously to offset the cost of a doctoral degree. And then I had this wild dream of going to law school. I said, man, look, I'm right here. There's Rutgers, there's Seton Hall, there's just so many opportunities. But then I looked through the lenses and the eyes of my three children. And when I looked at them and thought about the cost of education and what I got to do for them, I said, well, what will it really profit me to go to law school at this particular moment? But when I was thinking about it, I was captured by this image of Lady Justice. I was captured by it because it had the blindfold. You know, no, I mean, kids are intrigued, but adults are intrigued as well. And of course, you all already know justices and judges and lawyers and defense attorneys and public defenders. You know, it's a symbol that supposed to represent fair and equal administration of the law without prejudice. You all know that. And I've always been intrigued by this Lady Justice because of the blindfold. And the blindfold, you know, suggests to one that justice is blind to race. Justice is blind to injustice. It's blind to discrimination. Yet that's not what people experience in New Jersey courts, which could affect why some people don't desire to serve in jury selections. It could be because of their varied experiences. It could be because of the law. It could be because of law enforcement and police. It could be a variety of things that cause them to get that notification and to rip it up or to throw it to the side or to say, I'm not going to serve. And so it is incumbent upon us, as we have this frank, this honest, this sincere discussion about jury selection, that we begin to look at the things that are underneath that cause people of color in particular to not want to be on juries or to serve in jury pools. But that's not only it. It's not the discrimination that one has dealt with. It's not the injustice that they have dealt with. It's not even the racism that they have dealt with. It's the fact that in New Jersey, and I think many of you all are aware of it, the wealth inequities in our state for a white family, average family, I believe the last time I checked it was over $300,000. For Hispanic or Latinos, I believe it was over, the average cost was about $6,000 average income. And for the Black family, it was about 5,000. So what are you saying? Of course, I am a preacher. And so I am coming in that vein, and I'm coming in that spirit as a community leader. I'm not coming as a member of the New Jersey State Parole Board. I'm not coming today as the Deputy Director of Police for the City of Newark. I wear so many hats. I'm not coming in none of that. I'm coming as a concerned clergy, as a concerned community leaders. In fact, some people don't serve because they cannot afford to serve. Yeah, the pay is so minimum, and people do not have family leave on many of the jobs and many areas of the vocation that they work in. And so they're unable to participate because it would become a financial hardship. So when we're talking about jury selection, we're talking about jury reform, we're talking about this system in the state of New Jersey, how do we correct it? How do we make it more palatable? Well, one of the things we got to do and have to address is the pay for jurors. They have to leave their job. Many of them don't work in capacities or industries or fields that pay them for the time off that they will have to take in order to be a part of a jury. This is the highest tax state in the union. I know they say probably one or two more higher than us, but I've been living here too long. I don't think there could be another state higher than the state of New Jersey when it comes to taxation. And so it would appear to me that we could find the resources to support jurors and to be able to increase the pay so that they might be able to serve, because we want a fair representation of the community. Everybody wants that. Not only does the defendant deserve that, but also the community deserves to have a fair representation of the community. And so I think we have to address the pay. That's number one. I also think we may need to amend the guidelines, whatever guidelines or format or document that we use or that we have adopted in deciding what questions are asked of jurors when it comes to jury selection. We may have to amend that, or we may have to adopt some type of not only legislation, but a document that will be universal across the courts in the state of New Jersey. That could be it. I'm not sure, but I'm just laying this in front of you for consideration. Also, we may need to address the education in the communities. Some communities are not educated when it comes to jury and why serving is so essential and why serving is so important. As we've done, finally, here's the fourth one I suggest. We've done with voting in the state of New Jersey. I suggest we do the same with jury selections. Might be time for us to really consider those felons that have taken advantage of a second opportunity. Some have had third, fourth, fifth, whatever opportunity amount that they have had, they've taken advantage of it. And so it might be wise of us to consider them, as we have with voting rights as well. And so I laid those four particular items before you for consideration. I know that this room is filled with such astute, such scholastic and wonderful thinkers and minds when it comes to law, but I'm just a preacher that's been fortunate enough to advance myself in education. And I'm saying to you, it's time for us to reform this whole system. We all see Ahmaud Arbery. We see what's going on in the state of Georgia. We saw the jury selection. Let's be different in New Jersey. After all, we're different anyway, but we're different for the good. Thank you all so much for this opportunity to share my convictions and thoughts about jury selection.